WMBS, Channel 10, Milwaukee.
I mean, an earlier film I did, The Boyfriend, it didn't fit into the 2 hour slot because you can get six 2 hour films in and the people on the buses go back and forth and so on and so on. So instead of asking me to trim it, and I would have because it was too long anyway, I knew it was too long, they simply took out Reel 9. They took out the plot development, two numbers, and then they trimmed every other number. And so people say, oh, it's not a very good musical, is it? You know. Well, of course it's not a bloody very good musical, because MGM. Oh, that's why it isn't.
Weißen Rössel am Wolkensee, da steht das Glück vor der Tür und ruft dir zu guten Morgen, tritt ein und vergiss deine Sorgen.
It seems to me, just speaking very generally, that the musical comes from the operetta rather than coming from vaudeville and revue and then taking the influence of operetta. But the idea of stories told with songs seems to me to precede the notion of the revue and the vaudeville forms. I think it comes from Middle European operetta primarily.
There were, of course, various other forms which went into making this curious hybrid called the musical. I mean, there was music hall, vaudeville, variety, burlesque, and the development of the musical is really the story of how each of these elements was integrated into something apparently similar, but in fact entirely new. What gives the American musical its particular flavor, however, is the material itself. Not the form so much, but the feeling of the material, which comes directly from jazz and from Tin Pan Alley, popular song. Both of which give the form some kind of
wild and poetic expression. And I think of musicals as poetic. I mean, I think they are true poetic. Well, I think of the theater as a poetic medium, but and musicals are. Even if you're dealing with something that's bizarre entertainment like Hello Dolly, there's something magical about it.
Knock, knock, it really isn't fair. Knock, knock, I'm working on my charms. Knock, knock, a zombie's in my arms. Oh, that sweet affection, what is wrong? Where's a loose connection?
That's nice.
Yeah, the whole thing is very
good. When a person says you, that's when you're good. You impersonate a person. Better than on a zombie shoot, I can understand a person. If he was a good man, I can understand a person. If he actually was
and also, like, the juice of you, you're crazy. He's doing something, but I hardly hear it. The ending was great. Just a moment. Steve, can we get some dynamics into it? Like, a person, when they do the doo-doo-doo-doos, get quiet, and then sing again, so that there's that...
Possible, except those doo-doos are high. It's very hard.
Yeah.
That's really a question of delicacy, not volume,
yeah.
Because you can't get Donna to sing that
all
soft,
right.
You know.
Well,
let's hear you say it.
We'll be.
That's it.
But when I sing it, it goes, Bobby, baby, Bobby, booby, Bobby. Bobby, baby, Bobby, booby.
Supposing you had to say goody, how would you say that, Bobby?
Goody.
Yeah. Bobby, baby, Bobby, goody.
Bobby, baby, Bobby, booby, Bobby.
That's it. That's it.
It's
exactly the same vowel sound as good. Exactly the same vowel sound as good.
Bobby, Bobby,
booby,
Bobby.
Booby. First lips, booby. Bobby, booby.
Bobby, baby, Bobby, booby, Bobby.
You're still doing it.
Okay. You could drive a person crazy. Take 10.
Is it really?
Come on, they'll lose their notes.
Where's a loose connection? How long, oh Lord, how long? Bobby, baby, Bobby, Bobby, Bobby. You could drive a person buggy. You could blow a person's fool, doo-doo. Like you make a person feel all huggy. Why you make her feel a fool, doo-doo. When a person says, doo-doo.
Hey. Yeah, Donna knows, Donna knows.
That's when you're good. You impersonate a person better than a zombie should. I can understand a person if he wasn't good and dead, doo-doo. I can understand a person if he actually was dead. Doo-doo-doo-doo, exclusive you, elusive you. Will any person ever get the juice of you? You're crazy.
That's great.
This show cost under $700,000. That is not a great deal of money. $700,000 for a musical today is probably a good $250,000 less than most of the musicals that were done on Broadway last year. On the other hand, in 1954, when I did Pajama Game, it cost $162,000. Steve and I have a reputation for success, but the truth is that together we've never had an enormous hit. Company paid off but has made very little profit, and for some reason, I think because Follies was such a cult show and there's been so much written about it, the fact that it did not pay off was something of a scandal. I mean, the truth is it only lost $650,000, but to hear it spoken of, it was this great disaster economically. The reason for that is that everyone thought it was a success until it closed one day, and then they suddenly realized, my God, it never was a success.
There's a man in Chicago who does nothing but pull up the house curtain, and that's all he does. And I'm sure that he's receiving somewhere between $350 and $400 for doing this twice a day, you know, pulling a rope. And there's no way of having him do any other job. So that's, it's enough to, I don't know what kind of language I can use here. Can I just say whatever I want to say? Well, it pisses me off is what it does.
Come on, babe, why don't we paint the town? And all that jazz, I'm gonna rouge my knees and roll my stockings down. And all that jazz. Start the car. I know a whoopee spot where the gin is cold, but the piano's hot. It's just a noisy hall where there's a nightly brawl and all of that jazz.
Take a show like Candide. The reason it has not paid back its investment after 77 weeks is that the Musicians Union decreed that I must have 25 musicians, whereas I only need 13. So 12 of them are dead weight. That 12, at whatever you calculate, 300 and some dollars per week, is the difference between profit and loss. Their theory is we'll work out our problems. We'll do it via subsidy from the government, from large corporations. We'll find a way. You'd like to say it's short-sighted. On the other hand, you know it isn't, because they don't care if there's no theater.
Back in the 20s, however, there were several different forms, each claiming the attention of budding songwriters. You had revue, which was a collection of separate acts held together by a single theme. Let's do a revue all in yellow, for instance. You had vaudeville, which was a descendant of British music hall and was put together for an evening's entertainment by an entrepreneur.
Young Herman von Bellow, a musical fellow, played on the big cello each night at a restaurant where all the gallant and fair would drop in for a chat and a bite. He'd play tunes that you know by Wagner and Gounod to give the gay building a tone. But the place started swaying when he started playing a wonderful waltz of his own. I don't care what becomes of me when you play me that sweet melody. My heart wants to shout out, yay! Sing of joy, sing of bliss, home was never like this.
Then you had burlesque, which was essentially a cheap version of vaudeville. And finally, constantly in the background, you had operetta, which had nothing to do with anything American except for one thing. Musically, it was ambitious. It raised the audience's expectations of what could be achieved on the musical stage. Most songs were devised without any particular show in mind. If they didn't quite fit in one show, they could just be taken out and used in the next. They were marvelous individual songs, but they weren't integrated into the action or dialogue.
I thought you guys was never going to get through.
No, Larry, it can't be done.
What time is the call tomorrow?
9 o'clock sharp, Madam Vanderbilt.
When?
You heard me. And another thing, Dick. If you and Larry don't fix up the opening for that second act by tomorrow...
Excuse me, Mr. Morley. This is Miss Merrill, the feature writer of the United Syndicate. Mr. Hart?
How do you do?
Mr. Rodgers?
How do you do?
She'd like to do a story with you.
Gentlemen, you're about to be interviewed.
Wait till I fix my tie.
Don't you like being interviewed?
Well, I don't mind, as long as you don't ask us which we write first, the words or the music.
I'm not going to ask you that. I think our readers will be more interested in knowing how you get the ideas.
You tell her, Larry.
Oh, no. You tell her, Dick.
Suppose you tell me how you began.
Have you got 2 or 3 days to listen?
Yes, if you tell it to Mr. Rogers' music.
Laugh that off, Hart.
It's a long, heart-rending story.
Yes.
After many months,
years,
we went...
It's all your fault.
My fault? All you did was talk about your lyrics. Why didn't you let me play the music for him?
I'm sick of this racket.
Now you'll have to go into the real estate business with your father. Come on.
Murder, suicide, robbery, blackmail. Which one are you going to do?
The way I feel, I'd like to do them all.
Larry Hart's particular achievement was lyrics which were in the vernacular. That is, in a language which could be understood by everybody. They were no longer the romantic flights of fancy that the composers of operetta dealt in and loved, but they concerned themselves essentially with the sights and sounds and smell of America as it was when he wrote them.
What a beautiful, tough, hard-hearted town it is.
What?
Oh, Manhattan. We'll have Manhattan, the Bronx, and Staten.
From a journey to Niagara and to other places, aggravate all our cares. We'll save our fare.
I'm a cozy little flat in what is known as Old Manhattan. We'll settle down right here in town. We'll have Manhattan, the Bronx and Staten Island too.
So, you had operetta, which had raised the audience's musical expectations, as well as providing the form within which the best elements of vaudeville, music hall, burlesque could flourish. And you had lyric writers such as Larry Hart, bringing new, fresh language to what was being sung on stage. The question remained only how to bring all these elements together into something that was recognizable, in the vernacular again, if you like, but still unique. The answer, I think, was provided by Oscar Hammerstein.
He used lots of reference books. He used thesaurus and rhyming dictionaries of various kinds. And he did a great deal of research. He didn't believe in inspiration. Along with, I think it was Tchaikovsky who said that inspiration is 90% perspiration. I think he agreed with that.
There's an old man called the Mississippi. That's the old man I don't want to be.
In Showboat, he wrote the first book of a musical that was thoroughly integrated with the music. That is, where the music, the songs, furthered the plot. Where if you took out a song, you would have a hole in the plot. I've always thought of Showboat as a kind of American opera. Was an innovator, and I think he consciously tried to improve the theater in general, or at least his part of the theater. And he was also a very moral person, and tried to be the kind of person that he liked to write about. And I remember as a kid, you couldn't go near his study. If you made any noise, you couldn't play outside his window, or anything. It was very strict. The reason for that, he told me in later years, was that basically he was a very lazy man, and he had to fight that laziness with a method of work. And it was his idea that the world needed somebody to tell them about these simple fundamental things like love and faith and justice and honor. And I think that was pretty much the basis of most of his work.
Felt very strongly that in this country, in America, where people are love singing and dancing, and they all have a high sense of rhythm, and of course then you have the blacks, which have really contributed enormously to the music of this country and the world through spirituals and blues and the jazz. And I felt that it was rather strange that here there was no indigenous theatrical form, because after all, grand opera is typically European. The Viennese operettas are what they are. Gilbert and Sullivan certainly is typically English. And there was nothing that was typically American that you would call a legitimate theatrical form.
Before dinner, and it's where we went after dinner. And there was music every day, every day, every day. And curiously, it was show music. Shows like Merry Widow, Chocolate Soldier, Pink Lady. I can picture the score. They always sold the printed score in the lobby of the theater, and my parents used to buy it and bring it home. And up it would go on the piano. My mother would play it again and again and again, starting with the overture. I wanted Larry to work on it, but he wanted to go to Mexico. He wanted to take a vacation. and I told him if he didn't stay home and work, I was going to Oscar. And he told me I was right. He didn't blame me a bit. So I did. I had to. And from the beginning, Oscar and I hit it off beautifully. We understood each other. I knew what his words meant, and I felt that I could match them. The first song we wrote together was "There's a Bright Golden Haze on the Meadow." And that was the verse of "Oh, What a Beautiful Morning." The lyric propelling the composer into a musical situation. You couldn't resist those words. They were so lovely.
There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. There's a bright golden haze on the meadow. The corn is as high as an elephant's eye, and it looks like it's climbing clear up to the sky. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day.
Nobody expected the show to work, but we had a run-through one time when we were in rehearsal, and my wife was there, and we all wanted to get together and talk after the show, that is the staff. So I put my wife in a cab and sent her home, and I got home about 3 hours later. There was a little note on my pillow. It said, "Darling, this is the best musical show I've ever seen."
Chicks and ducks and geese better
skip. You see, I've worked with Dick Rodgers and with Oscar Hammerstein before. So I told them that I would like to do it, but what I would have in mind would not be a musical comedy. And of course, they said, "Fine, fine, do whatever you want to do, just sign a contract." And so we signed. And my contract usually says that I'm to direct the entire production. I took a pen and I inserted "the way I see it." But after about a week's rehearsal, trouble started. I said, "Agnes, this is all wrong. This is ballet. Number one, you're not gonna have an empty stage. Number two, you have to have the principals in it. Number three, make it more of an American folklore." And of course, she almost cried. She said, "You're ruining my dance. You're ruining me." Well, she had to do it. Everybody came to me and said, "Why don't you leave her alone? After all, give her a stage. I mean, a ballet is a ballet." I said, "No, not in this case. A ballet is going to be a ballet." She went to Dick Rodgers, and Dick came to me and says, "Come on now." Well, I said, "Dick, I explained it to you. This has to be integrated." Well, anyway, before long, Agnes de Mille, I was told, was saying to everybody what a son of a bitch it was. Kept nudging Oscar, integrate, bridge it. And I said, "It's not enough to finish a dialogue scene and then suddenly into a song. Now make the dialogue rhythmic, and then when the emotions are ready, we'll go into the song." Well, by the time we got through rehearsing, 5 weeks, no one came to me. And I was completely, I felt like an orphan. And I said, "Oh,
oh, what a beautiful moment.
Hammerstein had 10 years of failures. Dick Rodgers, for the first time, was working with a new lyric writer. Instead of Larry Hart, he had Oscar Hammerstein. Agnes de Mille, that was her first chance to break through on Broadway. The Guild was on the verge of bankruptcy. If Oklahoma had failed, they would be out of business. So I said, "You all have a big stake in this. And in order to show you that I'm not being capricious, I will promise you that if I'm wrong and all of you are right, then I will never, never direct on the stage again." So that was it. Then we went to Boston. We had no advance sale of any kind. it came to New York, and it was almost like a funeral, you know. Everybody was convinced that it would be an utter flop. Actually, I remember my own stage manager, and God knows, you know, no one is more loyal to you than your stage manager. He came to me while we were in a train, and he said, you know, Mr. Mamoulian, may I tell you something very honestly? I said, yes, go ahead. Jerry White was his name. I said, you know, it's been a great experience for me working with you. It was so interesting, so very, very new. But you know something, he said, I wouldn't give you 10 cents for this show.
Oklahoma, where the wind comes sweeping down the plain, and the waving wheat can sure smell sweet when the wind comes right behind the rain. Oklahoma, every night my hearty lamb and I sit alone and talk and watch a hawk making lazy circles in the sky. When we say, I-M-I-O-E-A, we're only saying, you're doing fine, Oklahoma, Oklahoma, okay.
And then, of course, the play opened in New York, and next day, you know, it was like a thunder and lightning, and tremendous success. You couldn't get into the theater. People were buying tickets at 50 bucks a piece, you know, in the corners of the street. They were advertising in newspapers that we'll give two pairs of silk stockings for one seat to Oklahoma.
It had a tremendously successful 16 years, I think, with Larry Hart. Dad had had a dry period up to Oklahoma where the success had evaded him. But they came together and some magic thing happened, and he took out an ad in Variety, the trade paper, listing about six or seven flop shows that he'd done over the years. And at the bottom, he said, I did it before and I can do it again.
I suppose the first example of ballet being used for other than decorative purposes, however, at least the first that I know of, was in On Your Toes, the show of the 30s, written by Rodgers and Hart and choreographed by George Balanchine. Concerned a young American composer who gets involved with a Russian ballet troupe and falls in love with the principal dancer, who was Vera Zorina. In the climax of the show, the gangsters who were trying to shoot the hero actually sat in a box in the theater, and the dancer tried to dance out of their way. The climax of it was indeed the actual ballet. It told a story that was necessary to the plot of the piece. The ballet was called Slaughter on 10th Avenue. But the point about On Your Toes was that it had attempted to use dance in a poetic way, that is to say, to use it to express states of mind rather than, or conflicts, emotional upheavals, rather than just as a number that would divert the audience and get a big hand. Of course, the problem of innovations is that people tend to imitate them endlessly immediately afterwards. I mean, as a result, was born the so-called Dream Ballet, which then, of course, every show used for 10 years afterwards. Every time anybody had a problem, it would be danced out on the stage. Falling in love, drunkenness, murder. You had to have your hallucinatory ballet. Toes. Finally, Vera Zorina had to put herself in the path of the bullet and get shot, which gave it, I suppose, what you could call a tragic ending. Later on, in fact, 14 years later on, Jerry Robbins elaborated on this whole use of ballet in West Side Story by not only using dance poetically, but as a way of characterizing the individual gang members, and through dance as much as through dialogue and through song. So, the idea of integration, that is, using all the elements to create something unique, using song, using dance, using dialogue, blending them together, dominated the musical throughout the 40s and the 50s. In the 60s, the musical moved in another direction, but there were probably other reasons for this.
And he was on the train, and he said, Jimmy Rado, that's another actor, and I have written a kind of a musical. I said, what is it? He said, well, we call it Hair. And he said, well, I said, where is it? He said, well, we only have about 10 or 12 pages. He said, opens it in a gym, and he shows me some of these scrawlings and scribblings that he had. And I read there was one scene that was quite moving about a young person, and I felt it was kind of interesting. I hadn't, there was no music yet. I said, well, come down to the theater tomorrow, we'll see, we'll begin to explore it.
This is the dawning of the age of Aquarius, the age of Aquarius.
The guys had an attitude that was original. I mean, there was a lot of preaching in it, of freedom, but it mainly was the attitude, their point of view.
Mystic crystal revelation and the mind.
From where we're sitting now, it's hard to remember, but their attitude to race and sex and dope just seemed slightly outrageous at that time. Well, there's a kind of a rhythm. There's a certain rhythm to a lot of African music. You know, that sort of... Well, it's really a Charleston rhythm. And that's all through Hair. And it's a feeling, you know, it's like... It's just a sort of a feeling thing to it. And I figured that feeling was really what was at the root of what made rock and roll interesting to me.
Give me a head with hair, long, beautiful hair, shining, gleaming, steaming, flaxen, waxen. Give me down to there, hair, shoulder length or longer. Here, baby, there, mama, everywhere, daddy, daddy. Hair, 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 blow it, show it.
I just listed everything about hair that they could think of, and they thought about nothing but hair. That was one song that was a little difficult to write because the form wasn't really organized. It was really like a recitation. So what I did, that tune, that was a tune that I sort of got into my head. It doesn't fit the words. You know, didn't come out of the words like most of the tunes. It was sort of superimposed on them.
You're up to your bad tricks again. Is There's jostling and pushing in these groups. Please remember, as we've said before, we're not the follow-up to My Fair Lady and Fiddler on the Roof and Hello, Dolly.
Hair had a kind of revolutionizing effect on what constitutes a musical. It dealt with themes that I felt were pertinent to our time. It was first produced here at the Public Theater. That was before it moved to Broadway. I had been producing Shakespeare mostly, and I thought, well, it was about time we got into producing contemporary works. This was some 10 years ago. I was not very close to the musical theater as a child. I never knew the theater existed, in fact. I came out of a very poor kind of neighborhood and poor people, and the music that I knew best was the street music, the most popular music you dance to in the street. And I'd know the lyrics of every song written in that time. They used to sell these pieces of sheet music, not with the music per se, but with the lyrics. And there were 100 best songs, and I'd know 100 of them. You know, that's we all knew them. But now and then, some Broadway tune would infiltrate. But they were the exception. They were a little classier. It took me a long time to realize that I really didn't know any of the musicals of Broadway, because Broadway was out of my class entirely in terms of going to a show. That meant money. We'd never even think about it. You have to think of the theater as reflecting a particular spirit of a particular class at a particular time. When I say I was removed from the theater as a boy, so are the majority of American people. Keep your skirts down. The theater's never belonged to the working class people, nor has it belonged to the very, very rich either. It belonged to a kind of a middle class nature, and particularly the musical. Has been entirely a middle-class thing. Rodgers and Hammerstein had a certain content. Rodgers and Hart had a content. And George Gershwin had a certain kind of content. It's a middle-class content. Don't think it was put there. What happened with Hair was that I felt that the music and the idea and the theater came together. Keep them away. Transition is here, and we're in the middle of it, so it's very difficult to pinpoint the thing that you're asking. And because the old thing is gone, it was going, and there are new audiences and new times.
Sun shining. Why don't you learn to lean on me?
Metropolitan Opera is usually an occasion for a lot of people to get dressed up in evening clothes, furs, and jewels, and then brace themselves for an evening of Verdi, Puccini, or Wagner. The idea is to see and be seen as much as it is to listen to the music. Well, this opening at the Met is not like that. If there are any furs in the audience, the odds are they're secondhand, and instead of evening clothes and jewels, you get blue jeans and love beads. And you don't get Puccini either. Instead, you get The Who. And who are The Who? Well, The Who are The Who. That's who they are.
Feel me. Touch me. And I took it home and played the first side. And I thought, well, it's the most awful rubbish I've ever heard. And I couldn't make out what it was about. You know, it suddenly started with, what about the boy? He saw it all. And I saw what, you know? And 21's gonna be a good year. Good year for what?
all these fantasy ideas, you know, when you become a star, you think you'll have a star on the door, and when you go on stage, the fans will blow. It was nothing like that. Kent comes in with this big baggy shirt on, these old pants, hair all over his face. I would go, oh, God, is this a director, you know? This isn't what the thing sounds like, you know? So Kent, we sat and we talked, but I sort of liked him from the very beginning. There was, well, he always reminds me of, like, Santa Claus, the way Santa Claus looked, you know? So the first day there, we started going through the wig bit. Which wig he wanted me to wear, a very long wig or a sort of very short one that moved. So he selected a very long one. Then he said about the short dress. Well, I didn't get a picture of how I was supposed to have looked. A mini skirt, and mini skirts are not in anymore. I didn't know what was actually going on, right? So then he said, the girl went out and got a little short skirt, and so I sort of laughed it off. I said, okay. So I was teasing him. I said, I have some textured hose, black with a few runs. He said, with a few runs? Great. I said, what do you know about runs? If your child ain't all he should be now, this girl will put him right. I'll show him what he could be now. Just give me one more night.
Tommy, I'm sure everyone in Hollywood running around with dozens of scripts trying to set up, you know, the ultimate trip of rock musicals. You know, I can just see these rather people who've never heard rock music. The Polo Lounge is probably full of them even as we speak now. They've probably got six scripts apiece, and they're all, and it's funny, down their deals only $5 million at all. But they're hard things to do, and they're costly things to do. The hard things to do properly, it's very easy to get someone up in front of a microphone and film them singing a song. And that's very cheap. And you could do a rock musical, I suppose, in those terms, you know, just a filmed rock concert. But to actually do an integrated sort of musical, that's very hard work.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, you in midair, send in the clowns.
The integration just means that all the elements should contribute, if not equally, almost equally, to the total effect of the work. Now, that's what a work of art is. And musicals have always been a hybrid form. And that's why many people who like opera disdain musicals so much, because it seems to them so hybridized. You know, you have a little of this, a little of that. It's like a stew rather than a piece that has some spine to it.
One who can't move, where are the clowns? Send in the clowns, just when I stopped. Opening doors, finally knowing the one that I wanted was yours. Making my entrance again with my usual flair, sure of my lines, no one is there.
When people say that musicals are approaching opera, that's something I think is a fairly accurate observation that's being made. Because what they really mean is that all the elements are becoming more and more pointed towards the telling of whatever story or idea you're telling.
All right, there it is. That's it. That's it. Numero shashigat.
Slow. Yes.
What the 60s represented was a kind of rebellion against a lot of things. But in the theater and music specifically, we had been working quietly in different kinds of cellars and attics, trying out different forms.
Look, I don't even care if that one overlaps, but just come in on your beat.
The relationship, the communication between the audience and the performance itself, it had become a very kind of solidified plastic product. Our
that whole surge of energy was to break that down, to break through the proscenium, so to speak, to get, it was one of the great forces of the time, too. And right now, after all of the things that have happened, it seems a little strange and irrelevant, but it was a terrific job. I mean, just to go through the proscenium, to break that down, and that was a very important form. And I think, you know, every so often the theater solidifies itself, or social mores do, and they have to be attacked many different ways. It needs it again.
There is great evil in the others. Much of it can be seen.
This is the hands moving together.
The Leaf People is the name of the tribe. They call themselves Hiawatha. Back in 1967, there was this terrible scandal involving the Indian Protection Service in Brazil, an agency set up by the Brazilian government to ensure that the Indians would not be decimated by the incursions of the white men. And it was discovered that through a system of bribes and corruption from top to bottom in the system, the IPS, the Indian Protection Service, was systematically destroying tribes at the instigation of the Serengueros, the rubber plantation owners. They were handing out disease-filled clothes to the Indians, things contaminated with smallpox. And the Indians have absolutely no immunity from white diseases. There's a line in the play that says you can't inoculate an Indian against a white man.
Okay. Rehearse, think only of the music. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
I hope it comes to the shot.
11, 12.
Because for too long now, the only kind of audiences that have been going to Broadway are audiences that don't go to get shocked. They go to get flattered. And it's time for that to end. Broadway is famous throughout the world. And for the last 25 years, it's been living on its reputation.
It's much more and much more fingers, elbows up, followed by the wrist.
I think musicals are very American, if not uniquely American. Also, I think of them as a New York form. It's not about being smart. It's about being alive. I never thought I'd be saying those things in public, to put it mildly. But I do feel it. Don't waste the feeling. I got nothing more to say on that subject.
And then I was asked to do, to meet Joan Littlewood here in this theatre. She had this amazing ensemble of actors being paid very little money, and they had to put a musical on in 2 weeks. And so we wrote it and put it on in 2 weeks, and that was Things Ain't What They Used To Be. And it ran here for a stretch of time through sort of capacity houses. But when I say capacity, like 12 people in every seat. And then, about 6 months after that, Things transferred to the West End, to the Garrick. But by this time, of course, I had Oliver on. Nobody wanted Oliver. I'd been touting Oliver around to about 12 different managements. And about 12 managements. One of them fell asleep on me, and then somebody else suggested I do it with an all-Negro cast, which now would be a great idea, but then it wasn't really on, you know? I've been involved in musicals that cost millions of dollars, where everything is terribly organized, and you get something that is very clean and tight, and certainly you milk applause, and you get long runs in Broadway where you get whole house bookings of women's gilts, and you go to the back of the theater and the smell of mothballs from the mink coats knocks you back. Sure, you can get that, but you don't get that here. because here every performance is a different performance. And every audience is a different audience. And the actors are trained here to react to the fact that if the roof fell in, they'd use it. And that's what I love, okay?
To me, this theatre represents all the very best there is in music hall and vaudeville. This is what it's all about.
End of story.